Hush! There it is.
Yes, I hear it too. Give me a lamp.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to follow. See where it leads.
You be careful, that's all I can say. I'm all a tremble. We'll have to sit down.
From the Penny Bloods present The Tapping on the Wainscot, adapted from the short stories by Alan Upwood. Part 1, A Visit to the Countryside.
The place, London. The year, 1905. And I was on my way as usual to the office, shared with my partner Mortimer. We are estate agents, he and I. Houses are our business. Buying, selling, occasionally renting out.
Morning, Hargreaves.
Morning, Mortimer.
Oranges from Seville are said to be particularly ripe this year.
Oh, I hadn't heard.
Indeed, your clothes suggest otherwise. Thick cut marmalade and toast, was it this morning? It does match the general pattern of the tie, though, so I shouldn't worry.
How does the blessed stuff get on there, I should like to know?
I used to have the same dilemma with honey. It just climbs out of the jar. As for Peters, why, I believe he has similar...
Peters is one of our assistants, a student of architecture. Often very useful when it comes to evaluating a house that's up for sale.
Meanwhile, I have something of interest here.
A new property?
In Sussex, Haylesbury Manor. Heard of it? Property of Sir Henry Whitman. His solicitors have sent instructions for us to dispose of it by auction.
The Whitmans of Sussex, eh?
The present Sir Henry is a distant relation, only just come into the title and estate after the last baronet died. Apparently he prefers to live abroad. To that end, furniture and effects have already been sold off at auction, and the house and estate are to follow. So you can take your nose out of that copy of the peerage and hop on the next train down.
I'll take Peters with me if available.
You will find him in the washroom. His breakfast was coffee and toast, I believe.
Peters? Peters?
Yes, Mr. Hargreaves?
We're off to Sussex. Bring the measuring sticks. We went down to view the place, and on consideration, once I found myself immured with Peters for the duration of the journey, I began to doubt my choice of travelling companion. Quite apart from the fact that he didn't know what to do with the measuring sticks. You don't propose to hold those things all the way, I trust?
I say no. Might be awkward. What? Where should I put them?
Try the rack above your head. I believe that is what they're for.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Let me...
It's all right. I'll give you a hand with those, shall I? Oh.
I say, this is quite the adventure. Sandwich?
Didn't you have lunch, man?
Oh, but it was hours ago. How long have we been on this train?
20 minutes.
Oh, then it's time for tea. Do you know, I have never been to Sussex. Look at the countryside. It's so...
soggy? Green? Peters is a good fellow and thoroughly to be relied upon, despite his incessant chatter.
So, after Dickinson bowled all out, the captain sent in Trevelyan, and it was all over in a matter of minutes. Well, half an hour. Perhaps longer.
His relentless enthusiasm.
Look at that cow! Look at that field! Such a blue sky! I say, these sandwiches are jolly good. Are you sure you won't have one?
And his propensity for accidents. And his clumsiness. Those blessed measuring sticks.
Oh, we're here!
Ow!
Oh, I'm so sorry. Is it very far?
A few minutes walk, that's all. Do you want help with those?
No, I can carry them.
As we approached the manor house, I thought to test Peter's knowledge and see what he made of Haylesbury Manor. Now, Peters, you're the student of architecture. Care to offer an opinion?
17th century, judging by the windows.
In good condition, too. The building was a very handsome old Jacobean mansion with valuable oak wainscot in all the principal rooms.
Always sad to see old places like this leave the family. Oh, I say, look at the door knocker. Isn't it magnificent?
Peters, with his usual enthusiasm, tried everything. The caretaker who showed us over it was a dear old lady who had been housekeeper to the last baronet and was evidently heartbroken at the prospect of the old family seat passing into the possession of strangers.
Oh, it is indeed, sir. I never thought to see the day and Sir Christopher, my late master, would turn in his grave if he knew what was being done with the old place. And I shouldn't wonder if he did know.
Hold the stick straight there, Peters. Hold it straight. I'm sorry, Mrs.
Musgrave, sir. And I've been here for over 20 years.
Ah, then you will know all about the place. Capital. And this room here?
This is the room Sir Christopher died in. He died in that very bed.
Oh, I say! What a beast of a bed!
Mr. Peters is by way of a student of architecture. Care to put a date to it, Peters?
I should say, Jacobean?
King Charles I once slept in it.
Impressive, most impressive. Peters, make a note of that.
Oh, I say, Charles I, eh? Absolutely splendid!
And may I ask Mrs. Musgrave why it hasn't been removed like the rest of the furniture?
It is fixed to the floor, for one thing, and so Henry thought it would fetch more by leaving it where it is. But I believe he would have it taken away now if he knew what I know.
At this, the old housekeeper nodded her head and pursed up her lips after the manner of old ladies when they have a secret which they are longing to tell, but which they think it due to their dignity only to part with under pressure. Why? What is it you know?
Perhaps I ought not to speak of it.
Peters, old fellow, if you finish with the bed, why don't you start on the fireplace in the next room? It's a great beast of a thing.
Alrighty-o. I love a good old-fashioned fireplace.
I shall join you presently. Now, Mrs. Musgrave, you were saying...
Well, sir, it may be that I ought not to be the first to mention it, but it's being talked of in the village, and if you didn't hear of it from me, you'd hear of it from somebody else, most likely. This house is haunted, sir.
Haunted? How? In what way?
You may believe me or you may not, sir. There are some who can hear it and some who can't. Some say it's only fancy and others that it's the spirit of Sir Christopher. But all I can say is I wouldn't pass a night in this room again, not if you were to offer me £50.
This was not very pleasant hearing. If a report of this kind were current in the village, it would be pretty sure to reach the ears of any intending purchaser and perhaps choke him off. An old family ghost of the traditional kind is sometimes considered an attraction to a venerable country seat. But any really unpleasant phenomena, particularly if of quite recent date, would be a very decided drawback in most people's eyes. Can you tell me exactly what you did here?
It is a tapping, sir. A tapping on the wainscot just over there. I was lying asleep in the bed, sir, for when the house was stripped and Sir Henry went away, I thought there would be no harm in my sleeping here, and I wanted to say I'd slept in the same bed as King Charles. But it's my belief that Sir Henry must have heard the tapping himself and seen something as well that frightened him, and that's why he was so anxious to clear everything out of the house and leave it.
Do you suggest, is there any reason to suppose that there was anything wrong about Sir Christopher Wheatman's death?
Wrong, sir? What should there be wrong? I'm sure the poor gentleman couldn't have died more peacefully. Miss Alice and I were with him the whole time.
Who is Miss Alice?
His daughter, or at least his adopted daughter. She had lived with him since she was a baby, and he made no difference between her and his own flesh and blood. And in my belief, it's on her account that Sir Christopher walks.
Why?
Because when Sir Henry came down, he turned her out of the house with nothing but the clothes she stood in. Sir Christopher hadn't made a will, and he came into everything as the heir. Miss Alice had to go to London and take a situation as a waitress.
You may leave by the end of the week. Here is some money. Mind, I shan't have you saying you've been ill-treated.
I will leave today.
As you wish. Of course, it needn't be like that at all if you agreed.
I have told you already I cannot marry a man I do not love, and now I will leave.
Oh, Miss Alice, wherever shall you go? Whatever shall you do?
Dear Mrs. Musgrave, I shall stay with Elsie Summers, and she has promised me work in her brother's restaurant. You mustn't worry about me, really you mustn't. I promise I shall write.
Oh, Miss Alice!
Could there be anything in that strange suggestion? Was it not more likely that the old housekeeper's indignation at her new master's conduct had made her fancy that the ordinary noises of an old mansion by night were a protest on the part of the dead? And have you heard the tapping since?
I hear it every night. I have shifted my bed to half the rooms in the house, but it makes no difference. Wherever I am, the taps come. And then they move along the wall and by the staircases and the corridors till they reach this room and stop there.
Have you followed them?
I did the first time. Now I daren't. But I got Jim Bateman from the lodge to come up one night and he heard them and followed them and they led him to the same place. And now he would no more cross the threshold of the house after dark than he would fly.
It was clear to me by this time that, whether fact or fiction, the story called for investigation. I'm not naturally nervous, and in spite of the disagreeable memories of the last haunted house I had spent a night in, I determined to face whatever there was to face in Haylesbury Manor. Mrs. Musgrave's story gave me much food for thought on our return journey. I wondered what impression the house had made on Peters. What did you make of it?
Oh, a wonderful old building. I shouldn't be surprised that there weren't a few priest holes in there as well. Jolly place for a treasure hunt, what?
Indeed.
Mwah. Mm-mm.
Good heavens, man. Are you hungry again?
Where are my manners? Mm. There's this tea shop made the most wonderful cakes. Care for a chussy bun?
I wouldn't have minded some tea. Measuring old houses gives one a thirst, I find.
Doesn't it just? Lucky, I thought to bring my flask. Tea? Or something stronger?
As we sat and ate and drank our way through ham sandwiches and tea, I mulled over the situation. I had arranged with Mrs. Musgrave to make up a bed for me the next night but one. Not in the haunted room itself, that I did not feel disposed to risk, but so as to enable me to be at hand when the mysterious tapping began. I was careful to say nothing in the office meanwhile, and above all to keep the matter from the ears of my lady secretary. Miss Sargent has a very special gift, that of second sight when asleep, and she had solved a previous mystery for me, that of the greenhouse, but at the cost of an experience to which I could not think of exposing her a second time. On the appointed evening, I returned, with a small dressing bag prepared to stay the night.
I've made up the room for you in here. It's not far from my room.
Why, this looks very comfortable. I thank you.
I'm sure I hope you will be, sir, as far as can be expected. Supper will be served downstairs.
You have a cook here?
No, sir. There's nobody in the village who will remain in the house after sunset. However, I make a fair supper, I think you will find.
Oh, I am sure of it. I take it you have heard the tapping again while I was away?
Indeed I have. And right urgent it sounded too.
I neglected to ask what time does it usually begin?
It's always been towards the midnight hour, ever since it began.
I see. The witching hour, as they say. After supper, Mrs. Musgrave nodded off to sleep in a rocking chair before the fire. Well, I lit a cigar and waited in some excitement for what was to come. The room in which we sat was wainscoted like all those on the ground floor. Every time a coal dropped from the fire or a window frame rattled, I fancied the mysterious summons had come and started nervously in my chair. I believe it is not merely fancy which causes us to hear so many more noises in a house at night than in the daytime, but that there is some scientific reason for it. Be that as it may, everyone must admit that the sense of hearing is more acute in the darkness than in the light. As 12 o'clock approached, I deliberately turned the lamp out, keeping a candle and some matches by my side. Hardly had I done this when I received a shock which nearly made me jump out of my chair. It was a tap, large, sharp and imperative, on the door of the room. In my agitation, the habitual phrase, "Come in," rose to my lips. And I uttered it at the same moment. My companion woke with a start and stared about her wildly in the dim firelight. "Come in!"
Oh, did you hear it?
Yes, did you?
Are you going to follow it?
Yes, will you come?
Oh, I dare not. Give me the matches. Don't go till I've lit the lamp for my sake.
I had been drawn straight to the door of the death chamber. As I crossed the threshold and the huge four-poster bed loomed up in the shadow, the character of the ghostly sound underwent a change. Instead of a single tap, travelling with the speed of a terrified man fleeing from pursuit, it became a harried knocking, moving around the room behind the wainscot as if in search of something. I could have sworn that someone or something was feeling its way along. The daunting sounds arrived at the middle of the wall, opposite the foot of the great bed, and became stationary. Once, twice, thrice, that awful tap broke the silence, louder and more menacing each time. Then all at once, "Damnation, my candle's out! Who's there? If somebody is playing a prank, there will be the devil to pay for, I tell you!" The flame of the candle turned blue and went out, leaving me in the stillness and the darkness with the feeling that I was not alone. I got downstairs again, I can hardly remember. But I am not ashamed to say that never was sight more welcome than the lamplight streaming through the open door onto the passage as I rushed towards it.
You've seen it.
No, but the light went out and I had no matches, and the tapping continued. It sounded quite frantic, as if somebody was looking for something. I went up to London by the first train and went to the office. Miss Sargent, have you a moment to spare?
Why, certainly, Mr. Hargreaves. I have finished typing up those notes on the Lockwood property, meanwhile.
Yes, I know what I said. And I still had no wish to expose her to any danger. But I could not think of anyone else who could so immediately help me. And her remarkable gift, well... So I told her everything. She listened with intense interest, not interrupting by so much as a movement till I had come to the end.
You must let me go down and spend a night in that room, Mr. Hargreaves.
Don't think of such a thing. I should never permit you to run the risk of such a shock as I had last night.
It is a matter of necessity. It is a matter of duty. I cannot doubt that tapping on the wainscot has a meaning. It is a message from the dead.
A message? I don't understand.
I don't profess to understand it myself at present, but I do not believe that it is an ordinary case of what is called haunting, where a spirit appears to be bound in some way to a particular spot. Neither do I believe that the object of this manifestation has been to drive the new owner of the house away, or to render it uninhabitable.
Then what do you suggest?
I feel sure there is a reason for the taps always coming back to one particular place on the wall of that one room. I should not wonder if there was something hidden behind the wainscot, perhaps a will or a paper of some kind.
Because when Sir Henry came down, he turned her out of the house with nothing but the clothes she stood in. Sir Christopher hadn't made a will, and he came into everything as the heir. Miss Alice had to go to London and take a situation as a waitress.
Pray heaven you are right. I will go down again and have the wainscot removed. But mind, this must be kept a strict secret. If Sir Henry Wheatman or his solicitors heard what I was doing, I might get into serious trouble for interfering with the structure in any way. Out of gratitude for Miss Sargent's suggestion, I invited her to be present at the opening of the wainscot. I had confided my hopes and intentions to Mrs. Musgrave, who was intensely excited at the prospect of justice being done to her beloved young mistress.
To think that I should never have guessed what it meant. And I thought I understood it better than anyone else, too.
Do you think there was any reason for the tapping on that particular spot, then?
Oh, to be sure I did. That is just where Miss Alice's picture used to hang, so that Sir Christopher could see it every morning when he woke. Sir Henry had the picture sold with all the others, and I thought that was why Sir Christopher couldn't rest in his grave.
It may be that Mrs. Musgrave is right. Very often the spirits seem to have very little motive, or what seems very little to us, for what they do.
Well, we shall see. Any luck yet?
Not yet, sir. What is it you're looking for exactly? A priest's hole?
Something like that. Well, we're not actually very sure. Some sort of hiding place.
I can tell you now there is no sign of anything like that here. Once more, in my opinion, this panelling has never been disturbed since the day it was put up. Lovely piece of Jacobean work as I ever saw.
I see. Very well. Can you put it back up again, please? It is imperative that you replace it so as to leave no trace of any interference. I shall make it worth your while.
Very good, sir. They won't know we were ever here.
Excellent. We'll leave you to it, then.
I was right, you see, miss. It's the thought of Miss Alice's picture that keeps Sir Christopher out of his grave.
Oh, come, Mrs. Musgrave. Sir Christopher is hardly an invalid suffering from sleeplessness. Now, have some more of this excellent chicken.
Mr. Hargreaves?
Your pardon, Miss Sergeant. Chicken and stuffing?
No, thank you. I have decided that you must let me sleep in that bed, Mr. Hargreaves.
But, Miss Sergeant...
I am a clairvoyant in sleep, as you know, and I may see something which will explain the mystery.
Miss Sergeant.
Thank you, Mr. Hargreaves. I think I will have a little more of that chicken after all. My compliments, Mrs. Musgrave. It is most excellent.
Oh, thank you, Miss Sergeant. It makes a pleasant change to have young people about the place again, I'm sure.
I had no answer to that, and we both returned to town in the afternoon to make our arrangements. The following day, we came down again, prepared to spend the night. My dear Miss Sergeant, your respected mother is not, I believe, accompanying you today. Yet we have, it seems, the same amount of luggage as last time.
Mama would insist on packing things for tea. Some cake?
Well, I suppose so.
Milk? Sugar?
Yes, please. Two. Good Lord, is that...
Milk for Mr. Tibbs. I almost forgot.
You've brought your aunt's cat?
Certainly. He proved most useful in the case of my uncle's phantom cavalier. There you go, Tibbs.
We arrived, cat in hand, or arm, should I say, and I hired a cab to bring us to the house. None of us intended to go to bed. The four-poster in the haunted room had been furnished with blankets and pillows to serve as a bed for the clairvoyant. Mrs. Musgrave was to install herself on a sofa before the fireplace, in which a fire had been lit, and I was to sit up in the next room, ready to come at the first call. If she had been surprised by the additional guest in the form of a cat, she hid it admirably. Mr. Tibbs behaved himself as a cat does. After inspecting the immediate surroundings, he curled up and went promptly to sleep until evening came.
I've made up the bed with a warming pan, and there's a warm brick.
And I shall be within two steps of the room.
Thank you, Mrs. Musgrave. You quite spoil me.
I'm sure I don't know as how you will sleep tonight, miss.
Oh, you may have no worries about that, I can assure you.
Well, I never.
Miss Sergeant fortunately possesses the power of falling asleep at will, Mrs. Musgrave. Now remember, I'm only in the next room. One shout, and I shall be with you in seconds. And Mr. Tibbs, of course.
Indeed, I will remember that, sir. Have you everything you require?
Indeed I have, Mrs. Musgrave. A book, lights and cigars will do me nicely. I'm bound to confess that I found it impossible to get interested in my book. Completely recovered Mr. Pickwick from the effects of his late fatigue of body and anxiety of mind. That illustrious man had been separated from his friends and followers for two whole days. And it was with a degree of pleasure and delight, which no common imagination can adequately conceive. What? Who's there?
It's only me, sir. Will you come and see the young lady? I think something is the matter.
What do you mean? Has the tapping begun?
No, that is what frightens me. This is the first night I'd not heard it for 4 months. But I think Miss Sargent sees something. And as for the cat...
There was not a sound to be heard, and the light had been put out by the clairvoyant's desire. But she was sitting half up in bed, her eyes fast closed, and yet appearing to stare with the most deadly fear at the opposite wall. Mr. Tibbs was pacing around in circles meanwhile, chittering as if at some bird he should like to catch, and also staring at the same wall.
What can they be looking at?
It must be the...
Leave it alone! Leave it alone! Leave it alone! Put it back! Put it back! Put it back! Put it back!
With these last words, uttered loudly in distinct tones, the sleeper's eyes suddenly opened, and she gave a fearful shudder.
Oh dear, I think I'm going to faint. You catch me!
What?
Well, really, sir, how could you drop her like that?
My apologies, took me by surprise.
The young people of today are coming to fairly beggar's belief.
Open the door, please, Mrs. Musgrave, if you would oblige. Let us be gone. It was too much for the nerves of any of us to bear. And the three of us did not breathe again till we were safe in the housekeeper's little sitting room downstairs. There, after she had rested and taken a soothing draught prescribed by the housekeeper, Miss Sargent related her vision.
I saw a picture hanging on the wall, the picture of a young girl, about 17, with blue eyes and very light golden hair.
Miss Alice!
Two men came into the room and moved about. I could not see what they were doing. Presently, one of them, who was in his shirt sleeves and looked like a workman, approached the picture and raised his hands to take it down.
One of the auctioneer's men, my dear.
At that moment, I saw suddenly appearing from nowhere, in front of the picture, a corpse.
A corpse?
Corpse?
Yes, a dead man in a winding sheet with his head swathed in white bandages. The corpse seemed to try to thrust back the living man. He went on without noticing it and took down the picture. I can hardly describe how, but just as though the corpse were not there. The dead man seemed to try to detain him, but he walked off with it. Then I awoke.
It was my poor master trying to save Miss Alice's nice picture.
I watched her with expectation. I had come to look on Alwyn Sargent as a woman of more than ordinary powers of mind, apart altogether from her extraordinary occult faculty, and I confidently anticipated that she would not let the matter rest there.
The picture must be replaced. We cannot leave things as they are. At all costs, the picture must be found and hung up there again, even if it is only for one night.
I should think that could be managed. I saw that Miss Sargent wanted to make a fresh trial of her clairvoyant powers with the picture in its place, and I dreaded the injury which these agitating experiences seemed likely to do her. However, I shared her feeling that the mystery must be probed to the bottom. It occurred to me that this was a matter that would be of some interest to that detective of the occult, Carnacki. He had been very helpful in the mystery of the greenhouse. I decided to pay a visit to his club to hunt him out and ask for his advice. Carnacki!
Hargreaves. Strawberry jams for tea, was it?
Eh? Oh, drat. I forgot to change. Listen, have you time to accompany me on a little jaunt?
Ah, the case of the wakeful Wainscot.
Oh, you've heard about that, have you? But how?
Why, I was at Catesbury soiree on Tuesday, and that charming Miss Sargent was there with her mother and told me all about it.
Told you all about it?
Yes. Shame you couldn't make it.
I was otherwise engaged. Now that I thought about it, I had been invited but was unable to attend, being taken up with the business of the house itself, but still, I felt peeved. It seemed to me that there was a damn sight too many men taking note of what Miss Sargent did and where she went. Not at all the kind of thing a nicely brought up young lady should have to put up with.
My dear fellow, of course I should be delighted to help out in any way I can. It sounds quite fascinating. I would, of course, be taking photographs if you permit.
But of course, and I should indeed value your expertise.
Excellent, excellent. Then it's settled. Will Miss Sargent be assisting us?
I should be doing Carnacki an injustice by suggesting his was anything other than scientific interest. Yet I would have preferred him to display a little less enthusiasm for Miss Sargent's presence, even so. Yes, yes, of course she will.
Good. I shall be curious to note what exactly she describes. It will make it doubtly interesting to be able to take photographs just as she goes into a trance. Now, where and when?
We agreed to meet at the station. Carnacki brought his equipment and left me guarding it while he visited the newsagents. Miss Sargent also joined us there with her mother to accompany her. Mrs. Musgrave would more than suffice as chaperone, but clearly the presence of two men appealed strongly to Mrs. Sargent's maternal instincts, and she would not hear of Miss Sargent travelling alone. And Mr. Tibbs, who, being male, could not qualify as sufficient chaperone, even if feline in nature.
Yes, and do please be careful with that round box there, and put that one, no, the other one, to your right, to your right. Yes, that's the one, on top of the blue valise.
There you are, ma'am. The finger.
What has your mother brought with her this time? Did you not inform her that we shall be there no more than 2 days?
I know, but that's mother. A day out means at least 6 pairs of gloves and twice as many handkerchiefs. And as for picnics, which reminds me. Sandwiches, anyone? Or cake?
My dear, what about tea?
I leave that to you, mother. We did pack the pot, I believe.
Oh dear, put your mind awfully. That round a black box. Just here, if you could.
My dear fellow, are you sure one carriage will suffice?
Yes, very amusing. Mrs. Sargent is accompanying us, as you see.
And Mr. Tibbs as well. Excellent. And how are you, Mr. Tibbs?
Thank you, yes. And here you are.
Oh, well... Thank you very much, ma'am. Much obliged, I'm sure.
Sandwich or cake?
I say, I am a trifle peckish. I think I'll have a sandwich, thank you.
Me back. Me roddy back.
All aboard!
We reached Haylesbury a little after noon, and quickly established ourselves at the manor. And after the staircase, where the phenomenon begins, it progresses up to this floor and into this room here.
What a magnificent four-poster! At least, Miss Sargent, you shall have somewhere comfortable to rest for the duration. Now, I shall set up one camera here, facing the wall, and another downstairs on the foot of the stairs. One more thing. Will there be a need for anyone to be moving between rooms? I ask because...
Ah, the threats. Well, I shall be just outside on the landing, and Mrs. Sargent has elected to stay here with her daughter. Where will you be?
I would be interested in remaining downstairs, if you permit, to follow the sound. I shall set threads on the foot of the stairs and on the landing, and take a chair at the top, where I can see both the floors below and the landing, and have an eye on the door. That way, should there be, after all, an intruder or a prankster, any physical movement on either floor will break the threads. I shall also set up the camera so that the slightest movement will trigger them off. How does that sound?
Admirable plan.
Oh, and Mrs. Musgrave, will she be joining us?
Mrs. Musgrave will join the ladies as she did last time.
Capital. Ha! I shall see to the rest of my equipment.
After supper, prepared by the good Mrs. Musgrave, and embellished with cold meats from Miss Sargent's seemingly bottomless carpet bag, we took our places. The ladies to the bedchamber with the four-poster, I to my sentinel post just outside the door, and Carnacki to his down below. I heard him cursing occasionally as he set up, bumped into furniture and dropped things. I called down to him in case he needed help, and he replied no, and to stop interrupting. Finally, he too settled down. A clock chimed the half hour. I was too intent, too alert to be able to read, and sat on the edge of my seat, listening out for every sound, every creak and rustle, from within the bedchamber and the landing and below. At last chimed the midnight hour. I had barely finished counting before it began.
It begins.
Yes. Where are you?
By the stairs. Stay where you are. I am waiting for it to go past the camera. I am certain it shall.
Sure enough, whatever was causing the tapping sound set off the camera. Once it had finished, Carnacki followed the sound upstairs and joined me on the landing. We approached the door to the chamber where we heard Miss Sargent murmuring. The door opened. Mrs. Sargent stood at the door, lighted lamp in hand.
Come quickly, gentlemen. It has begun.
Alone. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. Put it back. Put it back. Put it back. Call Hayward. Tell him to put it back.
Mrs. Sargent, please put out that lantern. The camera is about to... Allow me?
And then we saw it. Just after Carnacki put out the lamp, the camera, triggered by some movement by the wall, was also set off. And in the light of the flash we all saw, for the tenth of a second, the outline of an elderly man in nightcap and gown tapping at the wall on that bare space left vacant by a painting. Then we were left in darkness. I heard Carnacki set down the lamp, and we fumbled to relight it. Finally, a welcome glow showed us the room, now peaceful, with Miss Sargent sitting up on the bed with Mr. Tibbs walking round in small circles at her feet, her mother beside her, and Mrs. Musgrave with her hand over her heart.
Well, goodness me!
More tea, Mother?
Yes, thank you. Mrs. Musgrave has made an excellent breakfast.
Indeed she has. More toast, sausages?
Is dear Mr. Carnacki not joining us?
Dear Mr. Carnacki has popped into the local photographer's studio to develop the plates from last night.
I hope they turn out well.
He's never failed yet, to my knowledge.
So much science. I'm sure I don't know how you do it all.
Oh, practice makes perfect.
More bacon and eggs. I dare say the young gentleman will have an appetite.
Mrs. Musgrave, you're a marvel. I certainly shall make short work of that. And while I am...
Ah, back already?
Yes, and while I plough the fields of Mrs. Musgrave's generous bounty, behold my works and marvel.
There was indeed a sense of the marvellous in seeing a spirit of the afterlife captured on these pieces of board. The bearded face, the nightcap, the hand stretching out to the wall.
Oh, great heavens! Why, that is a master as I live and breathe.
Oh, Mrs. Musgrave, why don't I help you to this chair here?
Let me pour you some tea.
Why, thank you. I'll just take my breath.
Now, Miss Sargent, you mentioned a name last night which I hadn't heard before. Hayward.
Hayward?
The name is familiar to you.
It's the name of the auctioneers who had charge of the sale.
The painting?
Yes, the painting as well.
Then that is the next step. Have you their address to hand, Mrs. Musgrave? Capital. Then I suggest we finish up and take the next train back.
When the nighttime howls, in the chimney cows, and the bed in the moonlight flies, and inky clouds like funeral shrouds sail over the midnight skies. When the footpads quail, and the nightbirds wail, and the black dogs bay at the moon, when in the spectre's call.
Mr. Hargreaves, for you, Mr. Hayward.
Ah, yes, indeed. You have come about the sale of Haylesbury Manor.
More specifically, one item in particular. A family portrait that was included in the sale by oversight, which I have been asked to recover. I was wondering if you would allow me to consult your books and see if...
But of course, now let me see. It is of quite recent date, too. They will be here in this... There we are. Yes, Haylesbury Manor. I knew it was them. I have a system, you know. I have a system. Now, if it's portraits and paintings, it will be in this section here. Unless Jessop decided to put in the subsection of the other... No, he didn't. So here we are. Personal effects, landscapes, portraits. Have you anything? A title, for instance? Or a name?
The subject of the portrait was a Miss Alice, the late Sir Christopher's daughter. Fair hair, blue eyes.
Oh, a wristed portrait, then. I had not realised. Now that would be... Yes, fair hair and blue eyes. Ah, I do recall now a very lovely work. I think it is just here. Yes, there we are. Portrait of a girl, sold for £12 to a gentleman residing at Sydenham, a councilman by the name of Edward Thurston.
Paintings are a particular interest of mine, as you can see. Now, as it's a recent acquisition, I may not have the time to add it to the inventory. I have everything hanging in this corridor in order of purchase, and I think it is a further along. Yes, there it is.
Oh, may I?
By all means, be my guest.
I took hold of the frame with both hands, ready to lift it off its nail, and whether through chance or nerves, for my hands were trembling, somehow the nail came away from the wall and...
Good Lord!
I'm most fearfully sorry, I do apologise.
Good Lord again! Look at that! What is it?
Oh! An envelope.
Looks like a legal document of some sort.
It is. It's a will.
A will, eh? Well, well, well... Only goes to show, eh? You never can tell what's in a painting.
Indeed. Indeed. It was a will made by Sir Christopher in favour of his adopted daughter, Alice. The new owner of the painting, on learning of its significance, insisted on gifting it to Alice, who hung it back in its original rightful place at her proper home, Haylesbury Hall.
There's a gentleman asking for you.
Oh, has he the menu already?
No, he's not dining. He just wishes to speak with you.
Who is it, I wonder?
He's over there in the entrance. Do you know him?
I do not.
Well, you let me know if he's any trouble.
Miss Alice Wheatman, forgive me for troubling you. I represent Hargreaves and Mortimer, estate agents. I wonder if you have a moment to spare. I have something to tell you that is rather important.
Are you from Sir Henry?
No, Miss Wheatman, I am not. I am only in charge of disposing of the house. At least I was until it was discovered that... when I uncovered... That is...
Oh, I couldn't keep waiting any longer.
Why, Mrs. Musgrave, how on earth do you come to be here?
Haven't you told her yet? Oh, Miss Alice, you can come home, my dear. This clever gentleman found the will.
Oh.
All was not quite over yet, however. Miss Wheatman had been subjected to importunate visits from Sir Henry, and it seemed unlikely that he would give up Haylesbury Manor without a fight, especially once news got out that the will had been found. We arranged that Miss Alice should leave her place of employment immediately. We saw her home safely and went to call on her the following day. Mrs. Musgrave had come with a maid to help Miss Alice pack. However, when we arrived, we found the whole house in pandemonium and no trace of Miss Alice. The landlady, most distressed, informed us that Miss Alice had had a caller quite late in the evening, but she had made sure he left her after only half an hour. Then there had been another distraction, one of those travelling salesmen at the front, just as the oyster seller had come to the back door.
And I'm sure I don't know how it happened, but after I returned to the kitchen, I found the back door still open, and then I prepared the dinner. Only Miss Alice was nowhere to be seen. Well, it was most worrying. She was in the house barely 5 minutes earlier and would have said if she was going out, but I knew she hadn't. Well, I waited and waited, and then I saw something white on the ground just outside the back door when I went to let the cat in. And it was one of Miss Alice's handkerchiefs lying there on the ground. Well, I was in that much of a state, I called straight away for the constable, and he took one look and checked upstairs and saw how nothing had been packed nor taken, not even an overcoat nor hat nor anything. Well, I was that put about. I mean, Miss Alice was not the sort of girl to go out without a proper coat and hat on. That she weren't.
From the little description she was able to give me, I worked out that it had been Sir Henry paying the call the previous evening, and reasoned that he had accomplices who had got in through the back door while the landlady was distracted, and so gained admittance to Miss Alice's rooms. Though how they managed to spirit her away without making any noise, I quite failed to account for, until the constable on duty was able to enlighten me.
It is quite possible she was chloroformed, sir.
Chloroformed? Good heavens above!
Mr. Hargreaves? Mr. Hargreaves? Sir?
Yes, I am. Who are you?
Edward. Edward Pemberton.
The young man before me was an entirely presentable specimen, quite unlike Sir Henry in appearance. He bore his hat in one hand and a pair of gloves in the other. He looked, under the calm deference of his exterior, a much tried yet fearless young fellow. It transpired that he was Miss Alice's affianced, come to escort her to the station.
I have heard much about you from Alice, and I intend to find where she has been taken.
Well done, sir. Have you any idea where that may be?
She did mention about her cousin, Sir Henry. If, as I suspect, he intends to make her his wife, you may well have taken her to the family home.
At Haylesbury?
I believe they have one in town as well.
That'd be at the townhouse in Wickham Street, sir. Oh, pray do worry, sirs. I fear he's taken her there.
Is he here yet?
Who, sir?
The churchman, the reverend.
Dr. Merchant, he will be here shortly.
Has she come round yet?
Not yet.
Give her more.
I dare not. Do you want her dead?
No, that is not before we're married. At last, fetch him in. Now, where did I put the ring? Quickly, where is the ring?
The Reverend Dr. Merchant, sir.
Are you?
Actually, I am Dr. Teller. Dr. Merchant was unwell, so he entreated me to come in his place.
Irregular, most irregular. But we haven't time to wait. The young lady is most impatient to be wed. Who can that be?
Flowers, perhaps, sir. You did order some.
So I did. Very well, let them in. As I explained to your fellow clergyman, it is a rather particular situation, and the young lady is prone to phatic fits. However, everything is in order.
You have the license, sir.
As I explained earlier to your colleague, we haven't had the time or opportunity to acquire a license, but I have made the arrangements. You will be recompensed for your time. So, without further delay, will you please commence the ceremony?
Very well, in the ring.
Yes, I have the ring somewhere here. Oh, who the devil is it now? What on earth? Oh, carry on, man, never mind the door.
Very well, Sir Henry, but we must have the ring, you know.
Yes, one moment. The ring, I have it. Here it is. Here's the ring. Now begin.
The young lady appears to be unwell.
It's a fainting fit. She often faints. It's from joy. Now get on with it.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today.
Never mind all that.
Edward! Where's Edward?
If there is no man present who declare this marriage unlawful in the eyes of a...
Get on with it.
I declare it.
Edward?
You! He's quite right, you know. It is unlawful to kidnap and then force marriage on a young lady while she is unconscious.
Sir Henry Whitman, I hereby arrest you in the name of the law.
But you're a vicar, dammit. What the devil, sir?
I am, in fact, Constable Harman, Sir Henry.
Edward, who are all these people? Why is Sir Henry here? Oh, Mr. Hargreaves, what has been happening?
If you follow me, sir.
I'll do no such thing. Where is my manservant?
Tied up in the cupboard, Sir Henry.
Oh, Edward, let us be gone.
Outrageous! Constable, arrest this man for assaulting my servant. There was a great deal of commotion, which only lessened when Miss Alice got hold of a vase and knocked Sir Henry out with it. I saw the young couple safely into Mrs. Musgrave's care at a comfortable hotel, with a guarantee that they would be on the first train in the morning. Quite frankly, I doubted my nerves could stand much more if they stayed longer in London.
Mr. Hargreaves, I am truly grateful for your assistance in this affair. I, that is, Edward and I, would be delighted if you would be a guest at our wedding.
I accepted the invitation and was present when the portrait of Alice, which had kept Sir Charles's will so safely, was hung back in its rightful place at the manor house.
Oh, Miss Alice, it's as if you've never been away.
That was The Tapping on the Wainscot, adapted from the short stories by Alan Upwood, with Jonathan Bran as Carnacki, Kate Feeney as Mrs. Musgrave, Clive Marlowe as Hargreaves, and Julia Warren as Miss Sargent. Other roles were performed by members of the cast. The Tapping on the Wainscot was adapted, directed, and sound engineered by Julia Warren. Arnold Schmidt was executive producer.
If you liked our show, please visit our website at www.talesfromthepennybloods.org and follow us on Instagram, Mastodon, and Twitter. You can listen to our other episodes on Spotify and YouTube. And please, spread the word among your colleagues, friends, and family.